is with a very warm heart that we welcome you to today's episode of Tax Matters. My name is Olumuyiwa Matuluko. Last episode, we had a guest in the house in the person of Mr. Dele Ogun, a Nigerian in the diaspora. Mr. Ogun lives in the UK and is a lawyer licensed to practice both in the UK and in Nigeria. And in addition to that, he's a corporate tax lawyer. And we've decided that we need to tap into his experience, especially now that we are looking at taxation as a way out of the dire straits in which Nigeria finds itself. Mr. Ogun, welcome back.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Last episode, we looked at the major differences and similarities between Nigerian system, the Nigerian tax system and the UK tax system. Let us begin today on a digital note. E-commerce is booming. It's blossoming. At the beginning, it came in just through eBay, Amazon. Now in Nigeria, we even have our own platforms. I don't want to advertise, but you know what I'm talking about. So a lot of money is circulating in the air, online. How do we ensure that taxes due on commercial activities on the electronic platform do not escape?
Well, it's a challenge for all societies. Again, it goes back to the issue of visibility, because the online transaction, there you're not actually, in the conventional business, it's quite likely that you have a place of business, a physical place of business, that the tax authorities could see if they conducted their due diligence. You've got your name blazoned outside, mm-hmm. or you've got your stall in the market. E-commerce is all inside your house on your computer. So how would the tax authorities get to know about that? It's one possibility. Of course, the proceeds are from e-commerce. What should make it easier for the tax authorities is that one is not cash. That one is going straight to the bank accounts.
Yeah.
So obviously the bank account is where the information lies as far as the tax authorities are concerned. Now that everybody has their BVN or whatever number it is, every account is attached to somebody, there the tax authorities have the means to find out what is coming in. If they have reasonable cause to believe that that person is earning income through that source, but is not disclosing it. It's not that the tax authorities can immediately go and investigate everybody's bank accounts. But if, again, comes back to the lifestyle, this person is not known to have any particular line of business, and yet the lifestyle is such that clearly money is coming in from somewhere. At that juncture, the tax authorities are entitled to say they have a reasonable grounds to suspect that you have a source of income which you have not disclosed. You're not declaring anything. It's not on your tax return. Yet we're seeing your lifestyle. Therefore, we now seek to see your bank accounts. If you don't volunteer it, then you get appropriate court orders to gain access to that bank account. From what is there, you've cracked your e-commerce.
That's all well and good when the dramatis personae are resident here, the seller, the buyer. What about when it's across the border? When what I buy is from a company in the UK. How am I even sure that it's a company in the UK? It's a company in the clouds.
Mm-hmm. Why should the Nigerian tax authority want to tax that company in the cloud? Well, that company in the cloud is, it's deriving income.
Something as big as this camera.
Yes.
I ask a company in the UK. Mm-hmm. To send this camera to me. Mm-hmm. I pay online. Mm-hmm. They send this camera and is delivered to me,
mm-hmm.
who is qualified to collect tax on that camera? The UK government or the Nigerian government?
The UK government. On the basis that the person conducting the trade and supplying the, who has either produced or bought the camera for on sale to you, his profit is being made in his home base and is accountable in his home base to the tax authorities primarily.
Now, so there's nothing in it for the Nigerian government, even though I've sent out the equivalent of £5,000.
If the Nigerian government wants a cut of the action, it cannot focus on the income that has been, or the profits that has been made by the person selling you the camera. It's got to focus on your expenditure. So it's the expenditure line of the equation, and the tax needs to be applied at the exit points, such that if it's done by way of some form of quasi withholding tax, that if our citizens are going to indulge in online shopping, then we're going to introduce a tax for web transactions, for example.
Okay.
You then need to focus on, and you can't draft the legislation as we're sitting here in the studio, but you say we're going to introduce a tax for online transactions. Tax instruments have to be reinvented and revisited for new scenarios and new developments. Taxing online business or online business transactions, it would not be easy because it is, as I say, it depends on visibility. And anything taking place within the privacy of somebody's household is extremely difficult to tax. You may have to look in another direction and recognize that you're not going to be able to tax that one.
You mentioned something in passing, and that leads us to the next item on our list, withholding taxes. But we'll start talking about that after this short break. Don't go away.
Yeah, welcome. Yeah, waiting be this.
The deduction now for withholding tax.
Withholding guinea. Look, if you not pay me my correct money today, hey, munu no get me jina for.
But madam, should be your company paying income tax.
Yes, that one I enough load for me to carry. Why in a one come add join them again?
You see, withholding tax now advance payment for income tax. So when you do some kind of job, like contract, we go remove small from them when we won't pay you.
And when I go contract, I'm okay. No.
We must pay the money to FIRS within 30 days, and they go give us withholding tax credit note to take show say you don't pay part of your income tax in advance.
So?
Now to help make the money where you go pay at the end of the year small.
So this withholding tax one thing, it be like part payment of
Exactly, madam.
I beg you. Give me my check.
Remember, come collect your credit note.
Withholding tax, now for we own good. FIRS, it pays to pay your tax.
We are looking at withholding tax in relation to corporate taxes. Is it peculiar to Nigeria? Is it a Nigerian invention?
Oh, no. Withholding tax is global. All we mean by withholding tax is a mechanism for collection of the tax. It is withheld by the person making the payments. That's all it amounts to. Any system of taxation where the person making a payment is required to hold back some tax is a withholding tax system. So whether it's in the context of PAYE or is in the context of dividends or in the context of payments, distributions abroad, is particularly critical, and all countries across the world rely upon it in the context of international transactions. This globalized world that we live in, where companies are doing business in various different territories. The reason why withholding tax is so important is that once the tax has flown, once the money has gone without tax being withheld, it's next to impossible to collect it again. It becomes extremely expensive. It involves international litigation. You would have to sue the person. And you're going to have to sue that person, either tax authorities, get that tax, or have to go after the recipient in their home jurisdiction, instructing lawyers, perhaps in the UK, instructing lawyers in the UK to take that entity to court in order to recover the tax that could simply have been withheld before the payment was made. So that's the essence of withholding tax. It is simply a mechanism for collection. It's the ultimate form of anti-avoidance that is available to the tax authorities.
If President Buhari calls on you to advise him on how taxation can come to the rescue of Nigeria, which areas will you be looking at?
Well, we've touched on many of the areas because we are in recession. There is a limit to how much more you can squeeze those who have already been squeezed. These are the employees. This is why I'm not keen on any proposal to shift the burden of taxation further onto consumption taxes. Because even though the intended targets, unless it's luxury tax, if it's luxury tax one is introducing, and specifically in that sector, then I would support it. Because it's then much more clearly targeted than the general VAT increase. A general VAT increase will impact the masses, and you can't afford to do that. They're suffering enough at the present time. What you have to do is to recruit a well-trained, dedicated team to focus on the avoidance, because that is where the problem lies. That is where the shortfall in revenues can be quickly made up by spending, making the investments. This government has to be businesslike. I said we need to make the investment to bring in experienced, competent tax enforcement officers who have the experience of knowing what to look for and targeting the high wealth sector, because that is where the avoidance has historically been concentrated. Targeting that sector, looking at the inheritance tax field and say if that is a sector we have granted a blanket exemption from, we need to revisit it, because when the high wealth person dies, and especially high wealth individuals from this country, you will find that much of their wealth is abroad. Much of their wealth will be in UK properties that are increasing in value year by year, year by year. There's hardly a property in the UK that's worth less than $500,000 these days. So they've invested money in these estates. Those monies are feeding the economy abroad, the UK property sector and other sectors. When they pass, they have to pay, I'm saying they, these high wealth Nigerians who have invested monies abroad, monies made from this system but invested abroad, they have to pay inheritance tax on those properties to the UK government. And here we are here granting them exemption in circumstances where the origin, the source of the wealth was here. Are we Father Christmas? Are we Santa Claus?
About the month of September or October, the Federal Internal Revenue Service came up with a waiver of penalties and interest on back taxes going back 3 years, 2013 to 2015 financial years. That speaks to the talk about tax amnesty. Rarely do you go to a tax event without people talking about tax amnesty. Across jurisdictions, what use is made of tax amnesty?
Very positive use. I mean, there are a number of countries that have introduced tax amnesties in recent years. India, for example. What it does is this. It's recognizing that government does not have the resources to chase every single tax avoider.
Mm.
Yet government has a determination to stop tax avoidance. For it to work, government has to be determined to stamp down hard on those who will defy the amnesty. To say this is an opportunity for everybody to come on side.
Mm.
It's a state of emergency. Everybody come on side, regularize affairs. This is a fresh start. Anybody, any citizen who does not take up this olive branch that has been offered, then you only have yourself to blame when government comes down on you with its full weight and authority. Imprisonment, confiscation of assets. That is the role of tax amnesty, and many jurisdictions are using it to good effect. If it's done with the necessary sincerity, the political will, everything depends on political will. Any change that you want in any environment, if the political will is there, the change happens.
I'm going to ask you if what the FRS did went far enough. Like I said earlier, they waived interest and penalty. The identified taxes, the determined taxes, was supposed to be paid. And it went 2013, 2014, 2015. Okay. And some started asking why they didn't go the whole hog. Go back further, and then maybe a total amnesty. We're going to talk about that. But the first one is amnesty fair? In the sense that here I am, diligently performing my duties over the years. My partner, my colleague, my fellow market owner, my fellow colleague at work, has not been paying. And the government now comes and says, your sins are forgiven. Is it fair?
Well,
is it fair on those who have been paying?
I think the fairness on those who have been paying comes from this. Without the amnesty, or without an amnesty, that situation will continue. You will continue to carry the tax burden, and they will continue to live outside the tax regime.
And to enjoy from the fruits of the taxes that we are paying.
Yes. But amnesty is, those jurisdictions that have introduced it, is almost like a joint venture between the taxpayers, the honest taxpayers, and the government. They're joining hands to say, you who are the transgressors, the historic transgressors, this is your last chance. You come on our side otherwise. You see, the important part of any amnesty is not so much the carrot, it is the stick. That if you do not take it up, then you will see the consequences.
We are going to apply the stick.
Heavily. And that is the payback for the honest taxpayer.
Fair enough. So in those jurisdictions where tax amnesty has been used, is it one time or it can be done again? Because I remember somebody was saying that people could relax and say, there will always be amnesty. If I don't answer them now, 3 years from now, they will come with another amnesty regime. So in those places where it's been used, is it one time, one off, or do they maybe after a decade do it again?
The ideal amnesty program should be generational, once in a generation, because, as you say, if there's a belief or an expectation that it is not serious, the bus will come. There'll be another bus coming around. I'll catch the next bus.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
This is the nice bus, the only bus that will get you home. Get onto this one, or else the government will deal with it.
So it should be one time.
That's the way it needs to be done.
We are coasting on, we are rounding up. We want to look at incentives.
Mm.
People are of the opinion that some of those instances where we've given people tax holiday, tax waivers, and all kinds of incentives, that they have been misused. For example, when the telecoms companies came in 2001, they got a tax holiday, which was renewed because the government considered it as a new area. Export processing zones, so many of it. Do tax incentives really encourage investment? If yes, how do we maximize gains from it? If not, why do you think they don't really encourage investments?
My short answer is that they do not. They do not. And when you grant those tax waivers and incentives in sectors like telecoms, you're giving away money. You're giving, we as a country with needs are giving money away to the haves, to those telecom companies, to, and more importantly, we're giving money away to their tax authorities in their home countries. Because when we do not tax it, that is extra profit in the hands of the telecom companies, which would then be taxed in their home countries.
But you're always talking about, I mean, tax experts, like you're always talking about philosophies behind whatever you do.
Indeed.
About policies.
Indeed.
When you have a new area, all over the world, you encourage people.
Not necessarily.
I mean, you had your NITEL and you are not making progress. You didn't have up to 100,000 lines.
Yes.
And these people now came with GSM technology.
Yes.
Why are you saying we are giving money away?
But did they come because of the opportunity not to pay tax? Or did they come because here was this market of 170 million people, which the density of telecoms was at a ridiculously low level.
Less than 100,000 lines.
At least
50,000 lines.
So what they saw was a market for their goods and services. Did they really need a tax incentive to come and exploit that market?
The jury is out.
Jury is out. They did not.
I read a report 2 days ago that now the density here is 154 million lines.
Yeah.
154 million lines.
They did not need the tax incentives. They were coming. It was a new industry. It was a new revolution across the world. And everybody was looking for markets. Where can we go? Where's the next frontier? When you say there's the next frontier over there, do you think that people are waiting for tax incentives before coming into that next frontier? No. They're going to come in anyway. They will pay for the opportunities to come in, and you're giving them tax breaks, tax incentives. You're giving money away because you're not thinking through in the interests. Yeah, people. I'm not saying no thought was given to the issue, but no thought was given to the issue in the interests of Nigerians to say, do we need to give those tax incentives in that?
Okay, your parting shot. We've enjoyed talking to you. The Nigerian economy is hugely dependent on government. And for government to drive that economy, it means revenue.
Mm.
Less money is coming from the oil sector. So the government, for all intents and purposes, is broke. Do you think taxation can bail us out in the short term, in the long term?
The short answer is that it has to.
Don't forget that I say that even the money that you expect in the hands of Muiwa or Dele is coming from government.
Mm. It has to. Because we have no real alternative instruments at our disposal.
Mm.
The manufacturing sector is moribund, dead. The little manufacturing we're doing before is non-existent now.
Mm.
The agricultural sector still needs priming and pumping. And so all we can rely upon in the interim, because as you say, the the levers of the oil sector are out of our control. We're like a boat just on the ocean, waiting for the wind. As the wind is strong, we move. If it's weak, we're static. And so what have we got left? It can only be careful, thought through tax policies, properly targeted in the right areas that will not disincentivize peoples, add to the oppression of those who are already oppressed, but will release revenue opportunities that are rightfully belonging to the government. That means the tax breaks that have been given to the high wealth people, the tax breaks that have been given away to foreign investors in various sectors, those have to be revisited.
Hmm. Well, thank you most sincerely for coming on to the program. Wish you the best of luck and journey message back to the UK.
Thank you very much. Always a pleasure.
Our guest has been Mr. Adeleye Ogun, a true, true, true Nigerian, an erudite lawyer, a consummate corporate tax expert. And we do hope that in our own little way, we have further contributed to your knowledge of the workings of the tax system. Thank you for watching. Have a blessed week ahead.